substitution, too many men on the field, Saskatchewan.
Gizmo has a block and the sideline. He has not stepped out. He may go all the way. He needs one block and he'll do it easily.
Promise Mess I wouldn't do this.
McDavid stops up. What a move. Shoots. Scores!
Hey, it's podcast 62. Yeah, I know that it's an unusual opening. We normally don't have elks on our opening, Robin, but I guess we kind of have to tip our cap to the Edmonton Football Club for finally announcing a name that's actually gone over pretty well coast to coast in Canada. You know, not everybody likes it, I get that. But for the most part, I'm quite impressed with what they've done here. The logo is getting a great response. The helmets are getting a very solid response. The name is getting a good response. So, I mean, what more can you say? The only problem I have is I have the plural thing is a big thing for me, but it's not the end of the world. I have a tough time calling elks. Well, I'm an elk guy. I'm not an elks guy. So I struggle with that a little bit. But for the most part, we're going to be talking with Bryan Hall, a legend in the Canadian Football League and in the Edmonton market about the Elks. We'll talk about that coming up. But your thoughts quickly on it?
Well, I didn't know where to come down on the whole, what the new name would be. We knew it had to change. I wasn't sure what it would look like. But frankly, since it was released and put out there, Elks is fine. I don't struggle with elk over Elks. They are both actually acceptable,
yes,
for those who care about such things, because all the linguistic experts were out during the day it came out. You know, the people who spell your wrong and say irregardless instead of regardless, they were actually, you know, in on the, well, it should be elk. Well, no, both are fine. The name will grow on me, I'm sure. The old name was around for a long time. I'm sure we'll screw up and call them the old handle once or twice.
Oh, yeah.
In coming months, but I'm okay with the name. It'll grow on me. I like the merchandise. I like the colors. I like that they kept the colors. I think the logo is pretty darn sharp, too. So, yeah, I'm all good.
And thanks for joining us on The Outsiders, which is brought to you by the McIntosh Group at Remax River City. I'm Bryn Griffiths with Robin Brownlee. Before we start talking football with Bryan Hall, let's talk a little hockey right off the top. The NHL playoffs underway. We're taping on a Monday morning. The Winnipeg Jets could be out of the Stanley Cup playoffs, swept by the Montreal Canadiens by later today. So we don't know exactly how this is going to play out. Are you shocked by that?
Yes, I am, to be honest with you. You know, going into the playoffs in the North, Bryn, as everybody knows, I mean, the Canadiens were fourth seed. You know, they were far from considered a favorite by anybody. They had to get a bunch of players back. The Jets had looked very good in dispatching the Oilers, a series closer than a four-game sweep would lead you to believe.
Correct.
But they looked good. They looked crisp, and they were going to be the rested team. And here we are with the Habs. You know what? It's been said many times before. The old saying is this: there's no better place to play hockey when you're winning than Montreal. And they've got to be having a good old time out there right now.
It's crazy, really, when you think about it, because the Montreal Canadiens almost backed in to the postseason, yeah, the way they were playing down the stretch. But they got hot at the right time. Their goaltender, who some have suggested is overrated, and I completely disagree with that. I think Carey Price has proven that when the game is on the line, he can elevate his game. And he's done it for Team Canada. He's done it for the Montreal Canadiens in the past. He's doing it this time around. He has been better than Connor Hellebuck. And I think Montreal is full value for what they've done. The other thing, too, and we saw this here in the 90s with the Edmonton Oilers, they almost always opened up on the road. And the deal was, if we can find a way to win the first one, on the road, then maybe we can find a way to sneak out a two. Or if they lost the first one, they always said, we just got to win one. That's all we got to do. Now, the Montreal Canadiens go into Winnipeg, and they win the first two, and now it's trouble from a Montreal standpoint towards Winnipeg, and the Jets just have never really caught up. And then there's the Mark Scheifele thing with that whole suspension, and they just don't look like they got much left. Like I said, it could be a foregone conclusion by the time people even listen to this podcast, but good on Montreal. I'm very, very impressed. It's the old thing, get into the dance, get hot, and if your goaltender's on fire, you will go a very, very long way. And the rest of the series, I just don't know if Montreal's going to have anything left to take on some of these big American teams. Tampa looks very strong to me. Vegas and Colorado. It's a shame one of those two teams is going to be out here. But the playoffs have been fun to watch, Robin.
Well, I tell you what, the way that Vegas-Colorado thing started, you were thinking the Avs will be sitting somewhere with their feet up waiting to see who they play, because, man, that was as lopsided an opening game to a series as you can get.
Yeah.
And it's completely swung. But I'm with you on the Habs. While I hope they represent the Great White North in the playoffs, they got to run that tank awful close to empty to do it, because – let's face it, the game's played on ice, but on paper, they don't stack up that preferably at all to the teams that they might be looking at on the other side.
I'm not bilingual, but we would have to change our T-shirts to We the North to We the Nord. Is that how it is? I'm not completely sure.
Sure.
All right. Hey, let's also quickly congratulate Team Canada at the World Hockey Championship over in Riga. Wow. They dropped their first three games at the Worlds, and I kind of tuned out a little bit. I didn't have any faith. I went, maybe this is just going to be a year where they're going to, you know, it looked like they weren't even going to make the medal round or at least get into the playoffs. And then all of a sudden, they catch fire. And not only did they catch fire, some of the guys played exceptional hockey, and they go on and they end up winning in overtime to win the gold medal over Finland. What an amazing story that was.
Oh, absolutely. And you turned them out a little. I tuned them out a lot. I thought, that's it. That's done. They're finished. I was waiting for all the angst, you know, about how we overhaul Canadian hockey and wrong with our system. And you know what? That's why they play the games. And, you cheer for the story. And for me, you can talk about, okay, boys, it's not over yet, keep fighting, and all the cliches. Well, guess what, boys, it's not over yet. And that's what they did. They didn't just talk the talk, they walked the walk. And it's a great story when you come back like that to win against a terrific team from Finland who had to be heavily favored and were by virtually everybody watching. And it's, that's why you play the game, man. Why you play the game.
I saw a lot of people saying this is probably the greatest comeback by a Team Canada ever. And I'm thinking, okay, not so fast. This was a great comeback. But for me, the 72 series is going to be hard to match in a lot of ways. Team Canada got booed off the ice in Vancouver. Phil Esposito had to have the impassioned plea. Everybody just calm down. We'll get our shit together and we'll be fine.
Yep.
And to me, that's still the greatest Team Canada comeback, but this one's got to rank right up there. I was so impressed and so proud of the way the guys played, all of them, even the Calgary Flame players. The one guy in particular, Andrew Mangiapane, who I just think is a great, I think he's a wonderful player. And I thought he had a great season for the Flames last year, and he did carry it over. So anyway, congratulations to Team Canada, who I just, as I said, I just think it was an amazing story, and it's going to be, it's going to be hard to beat that when we have our team of the year voted by December. They were pretty fantastic, but wow, what a slow and sluggish start that was. Tough for me to say. Okay, Canadian Football League. It looks like they're going to play. It's starting to look like they might play. So we figured not only are they going to be playing, but they'll be playing with an involvement from the Edmonton Elks. So we figured we better track down somebody who's been watching football in the Edmonton market for a long time. Longtime broadcaster covering the Edmonton Eskimos, and now we'll be watching carefully the Edmonton Elks. Bryan Hall will be joining us. Got to tell you, too, The Outsiders is brought to you by the McIntosh Group at RE/MAX River City. Brent McIntosh and his team, always ready to help you out. Brent will be very excited on this podcast because he's the biggest Halsey fan that there is, and there's a reason for that. Because he before he became a successful realtor in the Edmonton market, worked at CJCA Radio when he was a young pup. And not only was he producing my sports show, Primetime Sports, he also was doing a lot of producing with Bryan Hall. And for those football broadcasts at Commonwealth Stadium, Brent was actually the operator and the producer of the broadcasts. So he would stand behind at the board and would mix the board while Bryan Hall and John Farlinger were describing the action. So I know Brent will be pretty pumped up about this podcast today, as he should. Had a chat with him this week. He tells me the market's still really hot right now. And that's a lot of that has to do with the interest rates. But if you're looking to sell or buy your new home, then give Brent a call at the McIntosh Group at RE/MAX River City. They'd be more than happy to help you out. You can give them a call, 780-464-0075, or check out mcintoshgroup.ca for more information. And tell them the Outsider sent you. And tell them you heard the Halsey episode, okay? Are you ready? Are you ready for this, Robin?
Ready to go. I'm ready to roll, man.
Okay, let's take a deep breath. Bryan Hall, up next. Joining us on The Outsiders today, this is a long overdue pleasure on our part. This is a guy Muhammad Ali called a feisty little guy in an interview that I remember hearing a while ago. And it's Bryan Hall, longtime voice of the football team here in Edmonton. Halsey, how you doing?
I'm doing extremely well, thank you. And hello, Robin.
How you doing, Bryan?
I'll tell you what, it's been a while since you and I have had any conversation.
Yeah. I tell you what, I miss going over to the stadium to help with football once hockey season's over, because that was my idea of a good time in the late spring and early summer. But you know what? I'll see you again around there.
I think we're going to have a really whole lot of new fun. I really do, with this new operation.
Hey, Bryan, let's talk about that right off the top here. Let's talk about the Elks. One thing that I've been so impressed by has been the response, not only in Edmonton to the name change, but right across the country. And I was looking at some stuff over the weekend, and the response has been like 90% positive on the name change, and everybody's quite excited. And when you get people in Toronto or Regina or Vancouver talking positively about the Edmonton Football Club, that you're saying something there. This is a real positive thing.
Well, it's not only positive, it's very, very exciting, because it's going to mean a whole group of new fans, and they will take to the new merchandise. As a matter of fact, all the merchandise that they had, and they had quite a bit of the new merchandise, has been sold. So they're waiting now. They've got a rush order so that they can meet the demand for the new merchandise. I mean, you know, they're kind of almost like the new kid on the block, except that they're not. And so I think there'll be we're the youngest city in Canada, Edmonton is, and we have a whole bunch of people who are from somewhere else in the world and who are, you know, getting into our way of life. Many of them that are here now probably have come in the past year and a half. We had no football last year. So, you know, it's one of the best stadium in all of North America. Never mind, it's the best in Canada. But we have everything else, a really solid organization, the great tradition. We've kept the double E. We've kept the, green and gold colors that are so historic. And it's, like I said, I just think it's just totally fantastic. I really quite enjoy it. Love it.
Well, Bryan, I wasn't sure how it was going to play out when we were talking about renaming the club, because there was a long list of names originally, and I looked at all of them, and, you know, sometimes change is difficult, but also sometimes change is good. And when it comes down to the Elks, and it comes down to a new logo and new merchandise, and let's face it, that's part of it in today's ball game, the merchandise, I think they hit it out of the park with the look of the logo and keeping the colors. How about you?
And they didn't do it quickly either. That's why it's so good. They did it with a lot of thought. They talked to fans. They talked to sponsors. They talked to everybody, and I'm sure also to football people. It was not an easy thing to do. And I can tell you this much, that's not inexpensive to do that either. And it would have been a lot more expensive had they had to, you know, change colors and all the other things. What they have done is they have added. They only took from the old Esks one letter out the S and put the L in, and they got Elks. And, you know, I mean, this is what it is. But it's really about the product on the field. And it's about going out and enjoying on a summer afternoon or a summer evening and just sitting there watching good football. You know that they have a good football team. They're always competitive. And at times they're a little controversial, which is the lifeblood of sports. So that's very good. I mean, they have everything going for them. And I might add here that the board of directors did a magnificent job. They took their time with it. They weren't pressured by anything. And Chris Preston, the new man who came here from Phoenix, Arizona. Can you imagine Robin and Bryn, you know, here comes a guy from Phoenix, Arizona to a new game of football, just arrives on the scene, and they shut it down, and they get involved in a name change controversy. And, you know, they gave him the reins, and he took them, and he ran with it, and he just did a terrific job, of course, with the board and a number of other people involved, you know, with their input. But just the same, he was the man who headed it up. And, you know, it just, they did not do it in a hurry. That's what I said at the outset, and that's why I think it was so successful.
I didn't do my math on this, and I like to think I'm somewhat well-prepped, but I'm not on this one. How many years did you do the football broadcast for, play-by-play?
45.
That's what it ended up at, 45 years, which is amazing. Great story. I remember going to those games back in the 60s in the Knothole Gang, and you were doing the games then with an unbelievable crew. But when this name change happened, it kind of stung a little bit. Totally understood the controversy, totally got why they had to do it. But, you know, it just kind of stung a little bit. But they've really done such a nice job here in the past week that I'm very proud of how they've done this. And I'm guessing that with your background doing the games for 45 years, you're probably feeling the same. I hate to put words in your mouth because you've got more than enough.
Yeah, but 45 years, that's broadcasting the games.
Yes.
This club is what, 72 years old? Yeah. I've covered them for 68 of the 72 years because they started in 1949 and I started broadcasting in 1953. 68 years ago. So, you know, as I say, if you want to be, if you want to use the term steeped in tradition,
yes,
that's this old guy here. I'm steeped in tradition. And, you know, I saw all the changes from the old WIFU and then the Big Four in the East, and clubs from the East never played teams from the West except in the Grey Cup, and went through the committee of one league and started in 65 broadcasting them. But the point here is that was at the very middle of just the worst time ever in the history of the organization, the 1960s. I remember we went through 21 quarterbacks before we finally were able to get something going. We went through a new coach. Neil Armstrong came in 64 after they turfed Eagle Keys. And Armstrong was here right until through 69. And then Ray Yock, former great running back in Iowa Hawkeye, with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, and he came in as the coach, won coach of the year. They got things going right away because Norm Kimball had come in, was the general manager, got things rolling. Then they picked up the big happening was getting 8 players who were released by the BC Lions. That included Tom Wilkinson and Bob Howes and Larry Highbaugh and so many others. And then they wound up going to their first Grey Cup 1973 since 1960. So, you know, it was... There have been so many different eras,
yeah.
But this is also the beginning. This right now is also the beginning of another era.
Bryan, I want to get into that, but I got to tell you, when you mentioned those BC Lions, I'm a little bit younger than you. I was a kid sitting in Empire Stadium, but even then I was wondering, what the hell are they thinking sending this little bow-legged quarterback named Tom Wilkinson? Why are they getting rid of Larry Hybaugh? He could run like the wind. And I think they did it because they had their hopes on a guy named Paul Brothers, who I didn't think could play a lick. And it took them years to find a quarterback after they let Wilkie go. That's a bad memory for a kid who sat in the stands at Empire Stadium and watched the Eskimos beat the BC Lions for fun.
But Robin, could I also remind you of one other thing?
Sure.
Who was the coach and the general manager at that time? Guy by the name of Eagle Keys and Jackie Parker. Oh, yeah. You know, they were with the Lions at that time. Yeah. Jackie, in the early 60s, when they had the big purge of the Eskimos in 1963, Eagle Keys was fired.
Yep.
Jackie had been traded to the Toronto Argonauts. So, you know, a lot of things had happened, but at the time that and I agree with you about the eight players. I mean, that's what really started the green and gold on their way in the 70s with Ray Yock, because they also went right after 73, their first Grey Cup since 1960. They also wound up going in 1975 to the Grey Cup. And that was a Grey Cup to remember, because that was in the bitter cold. And I tell you, it was in the bitter cold. They had to have one in the West, and it was promoted by a lawyer, Doug Mitchell, out of Calgary. His wife Lois later became our lieutenant governor. Son Scott runs now the Hamilton Tiger Cats. But Doug was a big promoter. He's a big man in Calgary, and he promoted that 75 Grey Cup. And Edmonton won it by a score of, if I recall, over Montreal Alouettes, 10-9. But it was bitterly, bitterly cold that day. I'll never, ever forget it. And as they were all standing in the bitter cold, and it was so cold you could see the cold hanging there at the stadium, McMahon Stadium, and as they were singing the national anthem, a woman streaked the field. I mean, we all remember what happened in 1975. But, you know, all kinds of crazy things happen. It can change, you know, in an instant. You know, snap a finger, life changes.
Halsey, I'll jump back into the you got Wilkie and we ended up with Paul Brothers and Don Moorhead and a bunch of other forgettable guys later on, and how I was a broken-hearted kid sitting watching the Lions get stomped by the Eskimos regularly, especially when they got that Warren Moon guy was pretty good too. But let's jump to now, because we're all anticipating the start of this season. COVID has wreaked havoc on leagues in the world. Now we're hoping for an August 5th start, tentatively, possibly. We're hoping for a 14-game season. What do you see coming down the road for this league, Bryan? Because it's been a tough year for this league.
Well, this league, as you know, Robin and Bryn, has gone through some very, very tough times. They have been saved from extinction, I think, perhaps, by, you know, the Senator, David Braley, who owns the BC Lions and the Toronto Argonauts, same time, that is, same year, same seasons. Back and forth it's gone. They needed help. David Braley was there. And as a matter of fact, on his passing, he still owned the BC Lions. And I understand that he's left, you know, some funds, etc., to have them carry on. But here, and you're right, Robin, this is what I'm concerned about. I'm not concerned about Edmonton at all. They'll be okay. They are okay. But I want to know about the other teams in the league. I'm not concerned about Calgary. They're owned by the Flames. I'm not certainly concerned about Saskatchewan Rough Riders. But, you know, and Hamilton, well, you know, Bob Young is there, and he's a pretty good guy and everything. He's stuck with them thick and thin. But I don't know about Montreal. They've got a new owner. He's a guy out of Toronto. and he paid the money to get the franchise, but they never played for him because COVID hit.
Yeah.
But he's still, I guess, paying the bills. And Toronto Argos, they've got the, you know, the big money people behind them. But I haven't heard enough. In fact, I haven't heard anything. I don't know if you guys have, but I certainly haven't, about any of the other franchises. I just heard that the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, because of COVID, lost $7 million. Edmonton lost $7 million. I haven't heard anything about anybody else. And I just don't know. And you can't play the game by yourself. So the future, if you're talking about the future, lies with what about the other franchises? And I don't know. I really can't give an answer. I suspect that it might be that the XFL, which is coming back into operation for next year and is now owned, as you know, by Dwayne Johnson, who played for the Calgary Stampeders. Wally Bono and he are still very good friends today. He and his wife, Dwayne Johnson, paid $15 million, his ex-wife, to the big boxing promoter, Vince McMahon. And they have the rights to the league. They've got some people together. They've got some, apparently, management people. They are talking about next season, and they are talking with the Canadian Football League. But we don't know anything about that either. I suspect they could maybe have a deal in the future, but we're more concerned about let's get something going right now. And back to your question, I don't know enough right now about what's going on with the other franchises.
Yeah, it's kind of a big concern. I had been told in January about the fact that it was the Toronto Maple Leafs Sports Entertainment Group that had kind of reached out below the border to see whether or not there might be XFL interest. Because you know what Toronto's like, they're always looking, they've always wanted to be in the NFL. They've always wanted that NFL stuff, even though they've had great, you know, the league, the CFL to me is as exciting as it comes. It's just, it's a different league. And I don't know why people can't watch football and enjoy football on both sides of the border in both leagues. I've never been able to figure that one out, Bryan.
Well, no, but here's the thing about it is first of all, and I suspect too, Robin, out there in Vancouver, it's the same thing. But, you know, we have Canada. We've got the Prairie Provinces, Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta. Now you have isolation out there with BC. And now it used to be British Empire loyalists in Ontario. They're now American. Ontario's now American. They, you know, we're part of Canada. They're American. And Quebec is France. They're all by themselves. And then you've got the East Coast group out there. Great group of people. But they're, I mean, we're a 6,000 miles coast-to-coast country.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but that's the way, as a Canadian, I look at my country. So when you talk about, Bryn, about the Toronto area, I mean, everything is American there. It's not Canadian. Don't kid yourself. They're not British Empire loyalists. They're, you know, maybe want to be Americans.
Well, I'm hoping that, you know, what about a merger? Like, would you, there's a lot of tricky things about that. And I know you're a big supporter of the Canadian guys playing the Canadian game and being somewhat protected. But if there was a merger between the two leagues, let's just go down that road for a second. How would you view the situation with Canadians holding some spots and making sure we keep some of the Canadian identity in the game?
Well, let me ask you, do you remember back in the 90s when we had several American franchises?
Yes.
What did we do?
Well, we basically played our game, did we not?
We played the CFL. Remember that, Robin?
Oh, yeah.
We played the CFL. But this time, if there's a deal with the XFL, it'll be different rules. It will not be Canadian, and it will not be fully American. First of all, we play in a different size field. Secondly, we have downs to consider, 3 downs to 4 downs.
Yeah.
And then you've got, you know, then you've got motion. You know, you can't have motion in the U.S. It can only be parallel. It can't be forward. And, you know, there's all kinds of things to take into account. We have live end zones. Their end zones are not live. I mean, there's all kinds of things. Now, what will happen is, and that's what they might be doing now, is sitting down and having conversation about, okay, let's say that we do have, you know, because they could make a TV deal. You see, the United States Football League, which operated some 4 decades ago, has announced they're going to come back next spring.
Yeah.
And then and they're going to play. Well, that's spring football. But the point here is that the XFL It may be quiet right now, but Dwayne Johnson is not a dumb guy.
Yeah.
He's pretty sharp, right? And he's got lots of dough, and he's got lots of pull because he knows everybody. So he can get a lot of things done and get it done in a hurry. But the point here is that he's not paying $15 million for nothing. And the answer lies, of course, for the success down there, and certainly here in Canada, it lies in television money. I mean, that's what it's all about. How much does the National Football League get in TV revenue and revenue every year? They're a $10 billion a year business now. Every club doesn't even have to sell a ticket. They've got everything covered. They're split every year. So they get like $200 million a year from their television, each club. I mean, it's crazy what goes on, but that's what it is down there. And that's what Dwayne Johnson and those people are looking at. So if you're going to sell the game and you're going to have Canada involved, you know it's not just going to be anything about Canadian rules, but it may be a game that everybody will like because the world is changing. And we've been talking about what was 30, 40 years ago, what has been over the past 50, 60, 100 years in the case of Canadian football. But things change from time to time because the world changes. So it'll be different. But I haven't given up that there could be something happening there.
Well, I do have to remind you that both you and I had the privilege of traveling with you and John Farlinger to both Las Vegas and to Sacramento. So we were at a preseason game in Vegas, and it was like 44 degrees Celsius. I still remember in that little jam press box. It's the only time I ever saw your hair kind of go limp. It was so bad that I couldn't stand it in the press box anymore. I had to get outside under those aluminum seats at the stadium because it was cooler. And then the other thing, too, was in Sacramento. It was so much fun as well. But the thing I remember about that was how much fun those fans had cheering on the Las Vegas Posse and the gold miners in Sacramento. The fans were great. They loved that game, Bryan.
Well, sure they do, because sport fans are sport fans. And if you have a country of 378 million people or whatever it is, you're not going to have trouble finding an audience. I mean, that's for sure. But again, I don't really care too much about what's going on with them. They can look after themselves. I only think about how would it affect everything here. And I believe that our fans would accept the fact that the world is changing. It'll be a good thing, and we will have football as long as it's enjoyable to them. They'll take it.
Yeah.
And listen, Robin, don't you agree with that? A sport fan's a sport fan, and if it's good, it's entertaining. In this day and age, they want to grab it and go with it, and they don't worry actually too much about what happened 60 years ago.
Yeah, I'm with you, Bryan, in the sense that you've got to evolve. If you don't evolve, you get left behind. And what I wonder is this, Bryan, I don't know what a merger with the XFL would look like. We can argue that and debate it if it becomes something that is actively talked about. I would like to ask you this, though. Well, that's a possibility, and it may be something that's good down the road. If it doesn't happen, can the CFL go back to existing on its own the way things were, or do we need to see some changes based on maybe some weaknesses that the pandemic exposed?
Well, I don't know that the pandemic exposed any weaknesses. I think there were plenty of weaknesses there before the pandemic. And the point here is that one of the big weaknesses has been ownership in areas like, Montreal, certainly, and now they've got a new owner we don't know anything about because he hasn't yet appeared. And Toronto, I mean, look at Toronto. As I said before, they're American in Toronto. They're not Canadian. And, you know, everything is about the United States. I mean, after all, they got a team in Major League Baseball. They got a team in the NBA. They've got a team in the NHL, which is basically, you know, all American franchises. So, I mean, so these are the areas that concern me. I mean, we're okay because we're all together in the prairies, but we're not when you're talking about in the East And you've also got private ownership compared to public ownership. And so there's a difference there. And it's just, there's just, well, you know what I'm getting at. So that's those problems were there before. But like I said before, I don't know what's going to happen with BC. Maybe they're going to eventually have new ownership there. But first of all, we've got to get back to playing. That's the big thing. And then we'll see what happens from standpoint of attendance.
Bryan, you've mentioned Toronto, and I've got to ask this. And I know about the rivalries between cities in Canada, CFL and NHL. I mean, covered the Oilers for a long time as well. But I wonder about a league. There was a time when Toronto was a flagship franchise. It was a Darlene and Candy and all the guys that came in, and it was a cool thing to go to. But right now, in the last many, many years, you've got the league's biggest television market, and they can't draw 30,000 people, 25,000 people for a football game down there. They move them to a new stadium. It still doesn't work. How does the CFL move ahead with its biggest market being such a black hole?
Well, that's exactly what I was referring to when I said earlier, when you asked that question about COVID and all of that. I said those problems were there long before COVID, and they still exist. The reason you don't draw in Toronto is because it's an American city. It's a big league city from that point of view. The thought process is entirely different, and the media people don't cover it. They don't cover the CFL like they cover the NHL, the NBA, Major League Baseball, and they've also got MLS soccer, which is Major League. So they look upon the CFL, I think, as the little sisters of the poor. I mean, that's what I believe. And they just don't, the media people down there, you know, what also has happened is it used to be the older media people grew up with it and they understood it and they backed it. You know, Steve Simmons has been around a long time, right? We all know Steve.
Yeah.
Originally in Calgary, and now he's in Toronto, and he's doing podcasts and all the rest of it and that kind of thing with the Sun newspaper chain. But what I'm getting at here is that these people knew about it, and Milt Dunnell and Jim Coleman and all these people of the years gone that they grew up with the game. Now in Canada, here you have a country of great diversification. We are so diverse from coast to coast. Great. It's a great thing, but we are. And Toronto is really a diverse city. I mean, the diversity there is huge. You know, you've got, as an example, the largest Italian population outside of Italy is in Canada. It's in Toronto. And they've got a huge Greek population. And it just keeps going from there. So they come in and they have an upbringing that is much different. And they grow up down there now with all the talk about the Leafs and the Canadiens. And that's true. But they're old, that's the original six, and that's always been there. But Major League Baseball is new there, MLS soccer is new there, NBA is new there, and that's what's happening, and that's what they cotton to, because that's what's pushed down their throat day and night by all media. Plus they get it on television from the United States. They watch American channels. Go ask the CRTC and ask the some of the operators of CTV and Chorus and Global and all these people about competing against the US TV stations coming into our area. It's the same thing. It's a different world down there. People have no idea how different we are as a country from, as an example, Toronto to Edmonton. It's huge. We're big difference between here and Calgary, never mind here in Toronto. So that's the problem. And it's not going to change. I do not see it changing until somebody gets hold of it and says, if we can somehow get a steady diet of coverage, boom, 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 and start doing something that way. That's the only way you're going to get it done.
To switch gears a little bit here before we let you go, and do you like the direction? Broadcasting has gone in a weird area. Now it's way more diverse than it was let's say even 5 years ago, but we're losing some really good young talent because of the way that the business has gone. Does that concern you a little bit?
What do you mean concern me?
Well,
what do you mean by that?
Well, we're losing some young talented broadcasters because companies are more interested in their bottom line. And I see sports being pushed out of some local markets, and I don't like it. It bothers me a little bit. The direction of broadcasting has been altered. I'm just wondering if you see it the same way, or you just think it'll find a way to survive.
No, I don't see anything like that at all. To be quite honest with you, no. As a matter of fact, our good young talent, Lauren Green and ABC. What was the big newscaster down there?
Jennings.
Peter Jennings. I mean, there's so many Canadians who are working in the States, and it has nothing to do with, small towns or anything else. It's just a matter of they're talented people. We're part of North America. I mean, we've got the 49th parallel, but what the heck does that mean, north or south of the 49th? We're all the same. We're North Americans, right? We're the biggest trading partners, one another. We're all together in this. So they just take a look around and see where the talent is. I mean, it could I give you an example? If you look at TSN and Sportsnet, a great number of those people that are there come from Edmonton.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really serious. There's more Edmontonians working down there in those two networks than anywhere else in the world, for heaven's sakes. They happen to come from Edmonton. Well, that's like, you know, as you talk about losing people, that's like coming from Canada and going somewhere else. Same idea.
Now, we look at you as being as Edmonton as they come, but you weren't born in Edmonton and you found your way here.
I wasn't. No, I was born in Toronto.
And how did you get to Edmonton?
I came here in 1950 because of the flood in Winnipeg. Schools closed early, and my mother and I, my father had passed on, and my mother, who was a nurse, said, I can't, it's too busy. It's April. I can't be concerned about you all the time. I want you to go to your sister for the rest of the summer because schools were closed. And I came out here and I wrote my mother, said, I love Edmonton. Boy, this is great. It'd be nice if we could move here. She did. That's how I got here.
Oh, see.
I had only spent the one year in Winnipeg after being in Toronto, you know, where I was born and went to grade school.
Oh, see, I got to ask you because I always, every time I see you, you know, in person, and like you said, it's been a while, I look at Bryan Hall and I see this guy who still has the fire, still gets excited about a good ball game and a good product. And I think Edmonton's pretty lucky in that sense. We've had some great broadcasters and writers in this town. But I look at a guy like Terry Jones. He started as a teenager like you did. He's not as old as you. I think at a guy like Jim Matheson, who I covered the beat with for years with the Oilers, he's been at it forever, but not nearly as long as you. What gets you out of bed in the morning when it comes to sports? I mean, you could do anything you want. This is obviously what you want to do.
Hey, listen, speaking about Maddie, Jim Matheson, I used to broadcast with his dad, Jack, who was the sports editor of the Winnipeg Tribune. And I knew his mom and dad, his mom, Peg. I knew both of them really well, Jack Matheson and Jack Wells and Bill Good out of Vancouver. You know, we all, and Jim Coleman and Milt Dundle and all that, you know, and Scott Young. I mean, Neil Young is, you know, his son.
Did okay.
And Scott Young was a terrific columnist with the Toronto Globe and Mail. So what gets me going is I like living, and I don't want to sit around and I don't want to be bored. I love people. I like to be with people. I like to talk with people. And I think there's always something new every day, something new to get excited about, something to learn. No. And that's what I love about this business, as you two should know, is that no 2 days are the same. Because there's different stories or there's different, somebody gets in contact with you about something and, you know, all of these things that happen. And, you know, as I say, I was always a busy guy. I was busy as a kid. I started working when I was 11 years old and I just enjoy it. I mean, that's the way it is. I don't want to sit down and I'm not going to look at television, or I'm not going to go just, I walk every day for an hour and a half. And that's part of my day. And I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. That starts my day. And I sleep maybe four and a half hours at night. And that's the end of my day. And the rest of it is all about who comes into my day and makes life really interesting. Because it's a hoot. I love it.
I got to tell you, so the 3 years that I worked directly with you at CJCA was so much fun for me, and working with Farley. I came in, I was in Winnipeg for a year. I took a 1 year gig to work with the Jets. That the rights changed hands. I lost my job to a guy named Don Whitman. No embarrassment there. You called me and you said Fred Fleming was leaving to go to Denver and would I like to come back? Those 3 years meant a lot to me. It was so much fun working with you. It was a rambling thought on my part, but replacing Fred was not easy for me by any stretch of the imagination. But working with you for 3 years on the Eskimo broadcast and working with Coetzee on the Trapper games, it was a great experience for me. I just wanted to tell you how much I love those 3 years.
Hey, listen, are you kidding? You know what they were? They were fun years. The business was a ton of fun at that time. And basically, too, because like you mentioned, Al Coates, we used to have Trappers baseball here, right?
Yeah.
Pacific Coast League. And it was terrific. And Freddie Fleming, you mentioned, he wound up leaving to go with the Bolin family, with Pat and his mother and the Denver Bronco organization, because he worked for the family. He was head of Fleetway Trucking, and his dad, the dad, Paul Bolin, during the big, number one, Leduc number one, was one of the original oil people here. And then, of course, Pat and Bill, who still lives in Edmonton, were going to school in Oklahoma, and he became a lawyer, and then hooked up with Peter Batoni, and they had Batoni Bolin Construction here. Built the Edmonton Coliseum. Well, Fred was going through all of that, having played in the CFL. And, you know, I used him as a color guy, and we had a lot of fun. And then we had other shows like Point Counterpoint, where we got at one another every day, and we used to argue and battle, and he'd get mad, and we, you know, but it was fun. It was, you know, it's showbiz, and all these things that happened. So, yeah, you bet. And then when I ran into that situation, and I called you and said, come. And we had, Bryn, we had a whole lot of fun working together. I mean, like it truly was a whole lot of fun. And you know, those are times that you really cherish in memory. As a matter of fact, doing this with you and with Robin reminds me of a lot of that time, which I really don't ever think about because I have no reason to until it's brought to my attention. And now that I think about it, we sure did have a whole lot of fun. It really was.
Are you not amazed, really, when you think about it? Like, we're on a Zoom chat doing this thing called a podcast, and you're on your phone in the comfort of your own home, and we're still broadcasting in some respect, but look at how things have changed in just the last 5 years, let alone the last 50, Bryan.
Oh, are you kidding? When I started, if you did a tape recording, you didn't even do it on tape. It was a wire. It was a wire that ran on a spool. And you used to have to crank the machine to keep it up so that you had enough power that you could do the recording. And when you played it back, you know what happened if you didn't crank it up. And then all of a sudden it's going and it's going. And
yeah. And here we are.
So that's how far back. I almost go back to the stylus, you know, like we have different writing. A lot of different writing instruments now. Mine was a simple stylus, you know, the old put the nib into the.
Oh, yeah. Bottle. Very Shakespearean like.
Or the girl who sat in front of you in school, if she had a pigtail, you dipped her hair in it. Yeah, okay.
Holy cow, that's, you know what? Halsey, when you talk about that stuff too, and I don't go back as far as you, but I took my journalism school with typewriters and carbon paper. There were no computers. But part of the gig that makes it a great gig, regardless of where you are, regardless of what you're paid, is the people. And I look now at baseball coming back down into the stadium in the River Valley. Randy Gregg and that group are bringing it back. The best time I ever had was the 6 years I spent in the press box covering the Edmonton Trappers. It wasn't the NHL with the better travel and the fancier hotels and the being the top beat. It was baseball. Your office is the River Valley. You look out at grass and trees. You watch some batting practice. You chat with buddies. You mention Al Coates, all the people down there. When you leave this business, when you retire, and maybe one day even you will retire, it's all about the journey and the people you meet along the way, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, as the wheel turns, you mentioned Randy Gregg bringing back baseball. They're going to start next year in the ballpark, right?
Yep.
Now, that used to be called Renfrew Park. And it was the Raja of Renfrew, John Ducey, who was the overseer. And he was, he was quite a guy. But you see, you know how they're going to operate Randy Gregg and his people. They're getting college kids and so on out of the United States to come up here. Guess what happened prior to the Trappers when the Raja of Renfrew was operating? Guess where they got their ball players? Down from college in the United States. And we had a lot of major leaguers of the future played here. Ron Fairley and Lenny Gabrielson and, Tom Satriano and, so many of them that went on to play in the major leagues. And the Raja of Renfrew in that, we used to call it, I used to refer to the ballpark. I used to refer to it, Renfrew, the jewel of the River Valley. And it really was. It really was. And I used to do the PA there. I used to sit up there with Don Buckets Fleming from the Journal, who was the baseball writer, among other things, covered curling, did a whole bunch of stuff for the Journal. But anyway, I used to sit up there and we'd crack peanuts. We'd even maybe have a beer and I'd do the PA,
And now the plate for the Trappers as catchers, right?
So here we are. All these years later, and Randy Gregg's bringing back the same format, the same thing. You know, the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Hey, Robin, ask Bryan about where you told me before we started taping today that you found out something that you never knew about Bryan, and that was a little play-by-play that Bryan did that maybe somebody doesn't know about.
Now, Halsey, I can picture, to me, you've got the delivery that would be perfect, but I didn't know that you called so much horse racing. That had to be a lot of fun.
For 10 years, I did the horses at Northlands. I covered racing for Ched, the Canadian Derby, the first of which was run here in 1954. Spangled Jimmy was the winner. And I used to go to the races every day, and I'd report live from there as part of the evening. And because I was always on the air at Chet, morning, noon, and night, so covering something somewhere. And it was a great experience and a great learning of everything. But eventually what happened in 1970, they asked me if I could be the track announcer at Northlands. And I did it for 10 years at Northlands. And I, covered every spring, summer, fall meet. And I covered I did thousands upon thousands of races. And as a play-by-play man, I can tell you one thing, and any play-by-play man, I think, will tell you this. There is nothing more difficult to do than horse racing. Absolutely nothing. Hockey and football, that they're a breeze because there's always some action. But in horse racing, everything is so different. You have to memorize by color. Not by number, because you can't see all the saddle cloths. You can't see all the numbers. Horses run side by side. You can get the one closest to you, but who's running on the outside? You don't see it. And what about on muddy days with the mud flying and everything's covered up, but there's always that streak down the back where the mud doesn't get to, and you can see the colors from there. So you've got to memorize from race to race, a field, say, of 9 or 10 horses, and then it happens in 2.5 minutes over a 7-furlong race. It's 2.5 minutes. And, they all jump out of the gate at the same time. And I've talked to a lot of people who said, it must be easy to do this. I said, give it a try. And the big thing that really gets them is when the horses jump out of the gate, all 10 or 12 at the same time, they don't know where to start. Their mind goes blank. And the strange thing that happens with the mind, I'll tell both of you, is that it your mind is such a marvelous thing. I mean, it's the best computer in the world. There's no computer in the world like the human mind. And what happens to you is this, at least it happened to me, is that when the race was over, if you asked me who won, I couldn't tell you. I would have to look at the program. I couldn't tell you because my mind became blank as to what happened that race, because it knows it has to get ready to memorize 10 sets of colors for the next race. And, you know, it happens, like I said, all at once. And, you know, so and you're there and you say, they're at the post. And then boom, 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 and then at Mayroff and taking the lead along the inside by a half a length. It's Fatty Go Easy and second on the outside by three quarters comes Beetlebomb. And, you know, boom, boom, and away you go. And when you're calling the first three on the air, you're looking at 4, 5, and 6. And when you get to call 4, 5, and 6, you're looking at 7, 8, and 9. And you're also watching for anything from the backside when you know they're coming around and they're coming to the top of the lane. They're in the home stretch. And at the 16th pole of the wire, having the lead along the inside by a half a length is Patty Goezy. Second on the outside is Atmos Value. And then here they, and then you got to watch for the horse charging from fourth or fifth, because you get a lot of things finished and photo finishes and things of that nature. And what it did for me was football became really so much easier, because my view suddenly, for whatever the reason, became greater, that I could see when the ball was snapped, and you got to follow the ball being snapped to the quarterback. But I could actually, while that was happening, because of the horse racing, I could see where the ends were going. You know, who was breaking down, who was breaking out, who was coming across the middle, and I could see it all. I don't know why. I just could, because of what the mind does. And, you know, because it's all about concentration. I mean, we all know that. It's about concentration. So, yeah, I loved horse racing. I love the horses. Love them forever. I had a horse when I was going to school, not a racehorse, but I had, I had a horse because I loved to ride. I still love to ride to this day.
Hey, this might be a horribly unfair question, but over 45 years of doing the play-by-play for the football team, can you give me your top three players? And I know that you're going to not want to do this. You don't want to do this, do you? You think you're going to leave somebody out.
No, but you know the best for me always, and he and I were such good friends, was Jackie Parker.
Yeah.
You know, Jackie could do it all. You know, when I started covering them, you played two ways in the league. You played offense and defense. You never came off the field. And Jackie played in the secondary besides playing up front on the offense. And a lot of people think that he was the quarterback when he came 1954, was his first year. They think he was the quarterback for that first Grey Cup won by the Eskimos. And it was not. It was Bernie Filoni, who then wound up going to the Hamilton Tiger Cats. Then Jackie became the quarterback. And Don Getty, who arrived at the same time, became his backup.
Yeah.
And they all became very, very good friends and, you know, things of that nature. But for me, yeah. And Johnny Bright was such a superb athlete. I mean, he really was. But these guys played two ways. That's why he was able to pick up the ball, Jackie, in 54, that big upset 26-25 over Montreal on the fumble by Chuck Hunsinger, and race all the way downfield as he did because he was playing in the secondary. But, you know, when you see that picture, if you ever see it again, you know who was running alongside him? Johnny Bright. So, I mean, that, you know, they were all different eras.
Yeah.
They were all different eras. But to me, Jackie, he could do it all. And he was a great receiver. He was a great team guy, terrific leader. He could beat you any number of ways. He was loved by all his teammates. To me, he was the best of the best. And there were a lot of great players through here. I mean, you know, you come later on. I mean, Warren Moon was pretty damn good. Right?
Effortless.
In 78 through 82, five yeah. Grey Cups in a row. And, I mean, he was absolutely marvelous. He's the only player in the Canadian Football and American Football Hall of Fame except that Marv Levy is going into this into the Canadian Football Hall of Fame. He's already in the American foot in the NFL, whatever they refer to their Hall of Fame.
Pro Football us, Hall of Fame in Canada. Yes.
Yeah, it's not the CFL in Canada. It's the Canadian Football Hall of Fame. It's not about the CFL. They're part of it, but it's not just about the league. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, but Jackie would be the best. And as I say, and there were so many others, some terrific receivers, some outstanding defensive players, really outstanding defensive players. So I don't know. It's tough.
And there's a lot of guys, you're right. So maybe asking the top three is a tough one. From an excitement level, though, how do you match Larry Hybaugh or Giz? Because, I mean, those two guys were amazing.
What did we call him, Robin? We used to call him High Jumping Hybaugh, right?
Yep. Unbelievable. He was so – I still – sorry, I can't get over it, Halsey. What were the BC Lions thinking, for crying out loud? This guy was – You didn't have to have more than half a brain to understand this guy was a player.
Oh, and not just a player either. He was an outstanding player. And he was just a little guy, eh? He wasn't big at all, but boy, could he jump. That's why I used to call him High Jumping Hybaugh, because he was short playing back there in the secondary. By some standards, he was short.
Yep.
But he could out-jump everybody. And when the ball came down, he was up above a much taller receiver who couldn't jump as high, and Larry would out-jump them. And then remember, here around the schools and everything, he'd go to the schools and he'd play their volleyball team all by himself and beat them. And,
yeah.
Man, what, don't you remember that? And yeah, the basketball, he would play basketball, and he would play against the high school kids by himself, and he'd beat their team. You know, I mean, he was incredible.
And then Henry Williams, wow! Every time you knew he was being crazy, huh? Just crazy times.
You get me about to get. Don't tell me about to get.
Get right up in your face. Hey, listen, we know you got a role. We'll have to do this again sometime. And this was just so much fun, man. Hey, before you go, there's one other thing I was going to ask, because in your office, you didn't have a lot of sports stuff in your office. You know, I remember you had your Canadian Football Hall of Fame trophy, which you should have, being in the Hall of Fame here. You had a picture on your wall, and it had, if I recall, Neil Armstrong, and you also had Sir Edmund Hillary. Why those two guys for you?
Well, I can tell you this much. Over all the years, I didn't save interviews. I didn't save pictures. You know, they're my memories, and I have them. But, you know, if I'd taken pictures, what a gallery it would be.
Yeah.
And I kind of wished I'd done that, but I didn't. But I did this one day. I did take a picture, and I wanted to make sure I kept it, and I framed it. And it was back when you had, Robin, remember when they had the instant camera, the
Polaroids.
What do you call it? The Polaroid?
Yeah.
Yep.
Remember the Polaroid camera? Mm-hmm. Anyway, guy phoned me at my office and said, a friend of mine, Halsey, he said, I've got a couple of fellas coming into town here. And he said, we're going to be down at the Westin Hotel. And he said, I've got a private, one of the little meeting rooms, and there's only going to be a very few people there, but I want you to come down. I want you to, you want to meet these people. I want you to come down. It was a friend of mine. And I said, sure. He said, oh, by the way, make sure you bring a camera. I said, oh, okay. So I had a Polaroid camera. I had a Polaroid camera in my car. And so I went down and I went into the room, and these two gentlemen are there. And when I saw them, and I thought, holy cow. So I said, I got to have a picture of each of you, if you would. And I had the picture of my Polaroid taken. And then I had them, I broke up a hard placemat, was all white. I said, this will be good. And I said, please write something on there. And they wrote, best wishes, Brian, and nice to meet you, Brian, whatever. And then when I went back, I took those and I had them glued to a mat along with the Polaroid pictures and had it framed. And that's the one picture that I have that I really, I said, boy, oh boy, because it was a wonderful several hours I spent. And I said, where else can you go with the first man in the world the first when it was really something to do. The equipment was so much different, and it was death-defying, and so many people had died, and no one had ever scaled Mount Everest. And Sir Edmund Hillary from New Zealand was the first to do it, and he was a big man. Well, anyway, he was the one man, and the other man was the first man to step on the face of the moon. Armstrong, Neil Armstrong, not the coach, Neil Armstrong, the astronaut, and a very quiet spoken guy, and, you know, the whole thing. But to sit there and listen to them for a couple of hours and everything, oh, and I thought, wow, now you talk about, but I just could not imagine. I still can't to this day. Scaling Mount Everest at the time Sir Edmund Hillary did that with equipment that was not like now, not the, you know, the space suits and the oxygen and all of that, and the bitter cold, and no one knew the route up there. You know, how do you get there? And every step you take, are you suddenly going to fall through into an open crevasse? I mean, yes. And that's the picture you're referring to, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then to wrap it up, because I started with it, Muhammad Ali, you had a chance to interview Muhammad Ali, or was it the other way around? Was he interviewing you?
Yes, it was Henry Singer and myself on the Sunday morning topic of sport, because Cassius Marcellus Clay had come to Canada, to Edmonton, as part of a tour because he'd been stripped of his heavyweight title, and the U.S. government was threatening to throw him in jail. He was a conscientious objector because of religious reasons to the Vietnam War. And he came along with his trainer, Angelo Dundee, and Sunday morning, we sat down in the studios at CJCA and did our topic of sport, which we did every Sunday morning, Henry and I, and we chatted with Muhammad Ali and Angelo Dundee, one of the most, probably the most famous trainer in boxing in the world, who died not very long ago, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And, but yeah, he was there, and he was absolutely outstanding. And as a matter of fact, I have to tell you, I don't keep things, but I kept the conversation I had with Muhammad Ali, and I have that on a whatever it is.
We got to get that digitalized for you. You got to keep that one. That's a keeper. I begged you to play that for me.
Yeah. I know I've got it on a reel-to-reel somewhere.
We'll have to fix that up. Hey, thanks for your time. Looking forward to seeing you during the football season.
Yes. I paused for a moment. I was going to say, God, I hope so.
I'm with
and
you.
I do. I hope nothing unforeseen happens that that we're going to be able to play. Don't you, Robin? I mean, we've got to play this year.
Got to play, got to watch, got to write, got to broadcast, got to get back to life.
Hey, well, hey. That's the great Sinatra song, huh? That's life.
That's right. Okay, time to wrap up our episode of The Outsiders, brought to you by the McIntosh Group at RE/MAX River City. Well, Robin, we didn't have to do a lot of talking in that last segment.
Surprise, huh?
Not at all. I thought Bryan really brought it today, but there's one thing I've known Bryan for a long time, as I think you've probably gathered by that interview. Bryan showed me one thing when I was a young pup learning, and that was you got to really raise your intensity level, and more than anything, your enthusiasm and your energy level's got to come up. Bryan's still got it. He's in his 80s, and he's still got it. That was fun today.
Halsey still brings it. And, you know, we should all be blessed with that kind of motor when we're his age, because he's still rolling along. He's still excited doing what he's doing. And I got to tell you, Bryn, that is one of the best times I've had in the many podcasts we've done. Like you said, I think we're at 62 now. Halsey, I tell you what, and I loved hearing a little sample of the old horse racing call. That was fabulous. I love it when we hear something we've never heard before, and I'd never heard any horse racing call from Bryan Hall. That was terrific.
A very good friend of my family, Dr. John Patterson, often who they'd go to the racetrack once in a while. I often thought that Brian was making up names sometimes down the backstretch, just throwing them in there for fun. And, of course, his description was classic. That was a blast. Also, his thoughts on where the Canadian Football League is going. And people say, well, yeah, but Brian's not really – he's not in as deep as he used to be. It doesn't have to be. He's good. The one thing Brian has never been short of is an opinion. And that makes him loved or not so loved. But quite frankly, I think that, as he said, it's the entertainment business. And Brian was very entertaining today.
He's a beauty.
Yeah, exactly. We've been blessed to have him kicking around, and it was fun to have him on the podcast today. Hey, anything else you want to talk about before we go? You good?
Yeah, I'm good. Hey, that's a grade A from top to bottom already, pal.
Hey, don't forget to check us out on Twitter. The handle's really simple. It's at Outsiders2020. And make sure you tell your friends and either hit the subscribe button or follow us button and follow our RSS feed on any of your favorite ear candy sites like Apple, Google, Spotify, Pocket Cast, wherever you're tuning us in from. And right now, the vast majority of you out there are getting us via Apple. But if you click on that RSS feed, every time we drop a new podcast, you get it. And the other thing, too, and we've talked about this, if anybody has any suggestions for guests that they'd like us to try to track down, drop us an email, because you can do that at theoutsiders@shaw.ca. So I think we've pretty much covered everything off there. And also, your support is greatly appreciated. Make sure you tell your friends that you were listening to The Outsiders and how they can get a hold of us. And also, we're talking with potential advertising partners as well, because it's nice to get a little bit of cash to kind of cover off some of our expenses while we do this. And we're having a blast with it. It's been so much fun, but we look to get bigger and better, right?
Absolutely.
That's it. Enjoy the rest of the playoffs this week, and we'll catch up again next week, okay?
We shall.
Bye bye, boys.
Have fun storming the castle.